Good morning and welcome to Interpol's career webinar today. I'm Andrew Nelson with our Human Resources Directorate, and I will be leading today's webinar about careers and positions and how to apply and how to get a job here at Interpol. I am currently in Lyon, France, and welcome all of our guests from around the world who are joining us today. We're going to take just a moment or two to let individuals join. From wherever you are in the world today, and we wish you a wonderful day, and we're happy to have you join us. This webinar should take approximately 30 minutes, and then we'll have some time for questions at the end. In case you have any questions for us, you can always add it to our chat, and we'll be responding in real time and at the end of the webinar. And you can always add me on LinkedIn as well, linkedin.com/AndrewNelsonProfessionalRecruiter. If we're ready to begin, all right, let's get started. Thanks for joining us, and we're excited to teach you a little bit about Interpol and our recruitment processes today. Our agenda for this webinar consists of four phases. I'm going to tell you a little bit about Interpol and our mission, our role, and a little bit behind the curtain of what we do at day in and day out. I'll tell you about Interpol's recruitment processes and how you can best position yourself to succeed in a future recruitment. I'll give you some tips and some tricks for how to apply to positions here at Interpol. And lastly, I'll walk you through our application review and interview process. Hopefully that gives you an overview of how you can best position yourself to succeed. So first, a little bit about Interpol. Interpol stands for the International Criminal Police Organization, frequently just called Interpol, using the acronym. We're based in Lyon, and we also have a second headquarters in Singapore, with regional bureaus spread throughout the world. These regional bureaus are usually specific to a region and provide additional expertise to specific subject matter that is impacting those countries in that region. Our vision is to connect police for a safer world, and we accomplish that through a variety of capacity building and training, database management, and international police cooperation events to unify and bring police together to better tackle the world's transnational crime issues. We have 196 member countries throughout the world. That is quite a few. That's actually more than some other international organizations out there. Interpol is a standalone international organization. We're not tied to the United Nations. We're not tied to the European Union. As long as you are a national of a country that is a member state of Interpol, you are eligible to apply to our positions. And interestingly enough, most of our employees are not police officers. Certainly that is our bread and butter, our core function is to connect police, but a lot of the jobs that we offer do not require any sort of police experience or any type of police or military or otherwise time in uniform. We do hire throughout the year, so that means that we have positions opening and closing based off of the needs of the organization. That includes internships. A lot of organizations might have internships that only open up, let's say, in the fall academic semester, or perhaps in the winter in January, February. But our internships open throughout the year, and so if you're a student and you're looking to join us as an intern, please keep an eye out on our website for those opportunities as they arise. We are looking for a wide range of professions, and most of them, like I mentioned earlier, are not necessarily directly related to law enforcement. We'll walk through some of those positions here in a few minutes, but that's one thing that we wanted to make very clear, is that Interpol is open to almost everybody. And one of the myths that we frequently encounter for people trying to apply or wanting to apply is that even though our headquarters is based here in France, you don't have to speak French to work at Interpol. Very, very few positions require you to speak and write and read in French. There are a few, certainly, but I would say overwhelmingly, 95% of those positions that we offer day in and day out do not require French. It's certainly a plus, and we do have four official languages for the organization, of which French is one, but English is the most common language that we use for business communication. And then we also have French, Spanish, and Arabic. So speaking English is very, very important to succeed in your application for Interpol. But speaking any of those other three, French, Spanish, or Arabic, is a very big plus for us. So let's talk a little bit about recruitment processes for Interpol. We have two paths to get a job here at Interpol. First is a contracted post. And what that means that it's open to all individuals who are nationals of their member country that is a member country of Interpol. You could be a civilian, you could be in law enforcement, you could be in any number of different careers, but you are eligible to apply based off of your nationality. It follows a fairly standard application procedure. You go onto our website, you fill out the application form, you upload your documents, you click submit in large measure. When we say a contracted post, we have short-term contracted positions and we have fixed-term contracted positions. A short-term is generally under 12 months, and a fixed-term is usually 12 months and more. And when we say we have a fixed-term contract, that means that the salary and relocation from your home to come to an Interpol duty station is paid by the organization, paid by Interpol. And so whether it's a short-term contract, you might not get the same moving benefits, but you would be paid directly by Interpol. So to recap that, fixed term, we're going to pay your salary, we're going to pay your benefits, we're going to contribute to your retirement, and we're even going to pay to move you to your duty station. If you're on a short-term contract, we will certainly pay to, we'll pay your salary, but we won't necessarily pay for you to move to the duty station. Ooh, I just lost the screen. There we go. For a contracted post, we have a maximum duration of 3 years, and there is no limitation on the number of times you can renew your contract, subject to funding and organizational strategy and need for the position. So we have several folks here at Interpol. In fact, I looked at these numbers the other day, and over 250 of our 1,200 or so employees have been with the organization for more than 10 years. And many have been here their entire careers, some 30, 35, 40 years. So as long as there's funding available, your performance is in line with our expectations, and the organizational strategy is there, you can continue to renew those contracts. The second option for a contract at Interpol is what we call a seconded post or a secondment. This means that it is limited to specific individuals. And in our context, that means you must be a law enforcement official or a government official. So you might not be a law enforcement officer, maybe you're a solicitor or a prosecutor with your government, but you're employed by your home government. Maybe you might be in your government's Ministry of Foreign Affairs or Ministry of your home office, something like that, the Department of State. Those kinds of organizations are also eligible to send officers to Interpol. But I'll back up. If you are not a law enforcement official or you are not a government official and you see a post that says secondment, you are not eligible to apply. Now, the way we determine whether you have the support of your government or not is in the second bullet point. You have to fill out a standard application, just like you would for a contracted post, but you also have to receive a letter of support from your administration that's sent through the National Central Bureau of your country. And that letter of support stipulates that, yes, you are a government official from your country. Two, that your administration supports sending you to Interpol. And three, they support you financially for your salary, your benefits, and your travel and removal to come to the duty station for the duration of your contract. And so what that means is that you will continue to be paid the same level of compensation that you were paid in your home government, but here in France or Singapore or where else in the world. And those funds are guaranteed by your home government. A National Central Bureau, if you're unfamiliar, is an office within each one of our member nations that is the liaison office. It's the focal point of our efforts here at Interpol headquarters to each nation's government, and that's how we share information, is through those National Central Bureaus. You could be eligible for an expatriation allowance on a secondment, and if you are, that would be paid by Interpol. The expatriation allowance is on a sliding scale based off of your family composition. Unlike a contracted post, a secondment is for a maximum of 3 years and can only be renewed once. After that, the intent is for you to return to home to your home country and share the experience, the expertise, and the training that you've received here at Interpol with your government. Our application process is fairly standard. You'll see we have our funnel of recruitment that leads down from the time you apply to the time that we select a candidate and onboard that person. We will do a minimum qualification review here in HR. We'll shortlist each position by the top most qualified candidates. We will test those candidates, then we'll conduct interviews, and then there's a selection process and an approval process that has to happen here at Interpol before we get down to the final candidate that we are going to bring on board. That entire process can take the entire process could take between 4 and 9 months, depending on the type of position, the type of contract, where the duty station is, etc. But be prepared for a somewhat lengthy onboarding process. I mentioned earlier that you don't have to be in law enforcement to get a career with us. Here's why. We offer a wide range of careers, and I've touched on some of those more classic police-focused positions here at the top: cybercrime, counterterrorism, organized and emerging crime, financial crime. But as you continue down the list, you'll see that there's a lot of opportunities for people who come from very, very different corporate-type backgrounds: finance, IT, legal, project management, human resources, for example. We have a very robust translation and interpretation unit, that be because we have different conferences, a general assembly, committee meetings that need to be translated into all four of our official languages. So there's lots and lots of opportunities out there. And so we encourage you to look at these positions and find something that aligns with your skills, your experience, and your interest, and hopefully you can find something that matches you here at Interpol. Currently, if you go onto our website, interpol.int, you'll find, if you navigate to our careers page, you'll find two different pages. We're currently transitioning from one applicant tracking software to a new one. So the one on the left is what we call Talent Link, and that's what we're currently using. The one on the right is called Recruitment Hub. And I'd say probably within the next 6 months, all positions are going to be found on Recruitment Hub. But it's important to note that if you're going to try and apply to a position today, you need to make sure that you're looking at both of those different links to make sure you're seeing which positions are available. Some of these positions you'll see have the word secondment attached to the beginning of them. Those are those ones that I mentioned that you must have your government support in order to apply. Others you might find say internship, and if it's an internship, just a quick note on internships, you must be currently enrolled in a university level academic program, whether that's a bachelor's degree, master's degree, or PhD. And if you're not currently enrolled, you must have graduated within the last year prior to the time you applied. So it's for current students or recently graduated students. And you'll see those indicated as internship. And then there's some positions there on the screen that do not have any sort of moniker in front of them, indicating that those are contracted positions open to everybody. We have about 1,200 officials at Interpol throughout the world. Of those 1,200, approximately 3/4 of them are contracted staff, and the remainder are seconded staff, sent by their home governments, detached, assigned, their liaison officers that provide their expertise and experience to Interpol. So now we've talked a little bit about what we do and what our process is like. Let's talk about how you can apply and some tips to really make your application shine. First, you want to make sure that you have the relevant professional experience, including the number of years of experience required for that particular grade. Each one of our positions has a grade attached to it. For example, I'm a grade 6. A grade 6 requires 3 years of professional experience doing that job. If you don't have that 3 years of experience, then you wouldn't be eligible to apply to the position and you'll be cut. So sometimes people say, oh, well, I'm going to apply anyway and see what happens. And certainly you can, but just know that we are going to look down to the day whether your experience is qualifying for that particular position. As an example, let's say somebody had built a career doing they're a finance person, and they had done a lot of work in budget, and now they want to move to accounting, and we would stipulate between the difference between being a budget officer and an accountant. And if they don't have the exact relevant experience or transitioning experience to qualify as an accountant versus a budget officer, then we would differentiate between that in our long listing. You need to have the required level of education, meaning if the position requires a bachelor's degree or a university degree or a master's degree is also quite frequent. Our management positions almost exclusively require a master's degree. So you need to have that education before you apply. You need to have the required technical competencies. So sometimes we'll say this position requires 3 years of experience working in counterterrorism in a maritime security context, meaning that you are an expert in all things related to maritime security, counterterrorism, piracy, etc. on the high seas. You need to make sure that you can check that box in order to be passed through for our screening process. And I alluded to this earlier, you need to be fluent in English. It's very rare that English is not required. However, there are from time to time positions, specifically I'm thinking of translation, or if the duty station is in a particular region of the world where that language is predominant. For example, if you're applying to a position in Abidjan, Côte d'Ivoire, then you would need to perhaps speak French for that position. But like I said earlier, 95% of all of our positions will require fluency in English. A little note on languages, a little tip. We loosely assign values to your languages based off of the Central European Framework for Reference for Languages, the CEFR, meaning that if you are a native speaker, you can put down French as your mother tongue. If you speak English, you can assign your level based off of that framework. It starts at the low end, A1, A2, then B1, B2, and then C1, C2. For us, if you say that you are fluent in a language, that means you speak at least at a B2 level. If you have a working knowledge, you can carry a conversation, but perhaps not at a professional level, we would call that a B1. And if you can just say some basic things, hello, goodbye, where's the restaurant, etc., that would be the A1, A2 level. we will really look for B2 or higher. If you're saying that you really speak that language, we would expect you to be able to certify that level of B2 or greater. We encourage you to target your applications, meaning you don't want to send out a buckshot of your application to a variety of different positions that you may or may not qualify for. That can actually hurt you if you do too many applications too quickly for too many diverse positions. It's incredibly rare that somebody's going to be an expert in communications and a top-notch accountant and an expert in financial crime for anti-corruption cases. Like, it's just highly unlikely. So we encourage you to really target, look for those applications that really match your skills and experience. You want to keep an eye on our vacancies on our website. We are also very active on LinkedIn, so keep an eye out for those vacancies as they arise. Like I mentioned earlier, we want you to invest in learning languages, specifically our four official languages. And as I had mentioned, the level that we really, really value is B2 or greater. When you're writing your cover letter, you want to make sure that it's convincing. And it really shouldn't be too long. We want to know who you are, why you want the job, and what makes you a good fit for that particular job. And if you can answer those three questions in a summary format, and really sell yourself as a candidate, that's what a cover letter is for. For the interviews and written assessments, we'll talk a little bit about this, but interviews typically occur 4 to 6 weeks after the close of the vacancy notice, and the written assessments occur a little bit before that. You can anticipate working either in a Microsoft Word or Microsoft Excel environment to do those written assessments. It depends on the position, obviously, but you want to be familiar with quickly analyzing and producing summaries, memos, making calculations, etc., depending on the position, and analyzing new data and coming up with a reasoned response for how you would tackle that issue at Interpol. So if you want us to read your cover letter, you should put it on the first page of a combined document, and then put your CV on page 2, and then save it as a PDF. Often people will spend hours and hours putting together the perfect cover letter, and then it's either not saved as a PDF, and so it might come through with weird characters, and so it doesn't read well, or perhaps it's buried under other certifications, degrees, etc., and we might not see it right away. So if you want us to read it, the best thing you can do is make sure that it is at the top, and it's the cover letter, the first thing that we see, and save it as a PDF to make sure that it comes through the way just like you want. It should never be more than one page. You might have an exquisite career with lots and lots of value, but make sure that you can condense that experience down to one page or less. And what you should really be aiming for, the objective of the cover letter, is to make sure that the recruiter and the hiring manager see that this job really matches your skills, your experience, that you are the logical candidate for this position because you bring the summation of all the things that we need to do that job. It's important to avoid elements of a cover letter that will detract from that objective. For example, you want to highlight your key motivations. You understand what it means to work for Interpol, what we do, why you want to work for us, why the location is important for you or for your family or for your own personal growth, a challenge that you might be pursuing. You want to avoid unnecessary filler phrases. This just drives me nuts. I am applying for the position of criminal intelligence officer. Well, yes, I know that. I can see it right there. That's the position you applied for. Or my name is. Well, yeah, I can find that out too. So take out the fluff and focus on what's most important. And then last, if you have the ability, we are Interpol, and so we don't necessarily go out and publish who does what where. But if you know the hiring manager, or you know the unit, or you can at least use a generic title such as director, counterterrorism, or go on LinkedIn and see if you can network and find out who the person might be. Worst case scenario, customize the letter and say, Dear Secretary General. Because at the end of the day, the Secretary General is the final authority for making all hiring decisions for Interpol. So when you're writing a cover a resume, a CV, we really encourage you to proofread, spell check, and format that CV. Do it multiple times and make sure that it's correct. If English isn't your first language, run it through different software, ask friends who might be better at English grammar, but please make sure it reads well. You can submit a resume in any of our official languages, but English is the most common, the most recognized, and what I would encourage the most. Where do you put your educational background? There's some different theories on this. My personal philosophy as a recruiter is that I want to see that you meet the minimum qualifications as quickly as possible. And for me, that means that I know that you have, if the position requires a master's degree, I want to know that you have a master's degree immediately. So I'd say put that higher on the list. There's an alternative of, you know, you might have 30 years of experience and really have a strong professional background, and so your education, that the degree you got 30 years ago really isn't as worth as much. I certainly can respect that, but from a screening point of view, if I put on my HR hat, I want to know that you meet those minimum qualifications, and I want to know very, very quickly. So I let you decide and figure out how to tackle that, but my personal recommendation is to have your name at the top, perhaps a summary about yourself, and then your education, one or two lines, what degrees you have and why that qualifies for this position. You also want to avoid using paragraphs in your CV. Those are big blocks of text that really distract the reader. And I think what people are trying to do is game the system and say, if we're using AI to evaluate your CV, that you get all those right keywords and buzzwords in there. First of all, we don't use AI to evaluate your CV. And two, it can be quite distracting and detracting from your CV. So please avoid that. We want to know the exact dates of your employment whenever possible. Let's say you are selected for a position here at Interpol. We are going to measure down to the day, and we're going to require proof of employment of your what you put on your CV. So keep that in mind, and it would help us long-term if we had those exact dates up front. So when you're putting down elements on your CV, you want to ask yourself, what did I actually do? What did I accomplish in this position? And when you can answer that question, those are the things that you want to put in your CV. We don't want to see a regurgitation of your job description. The employee is required to do X, Y, and Z. No, we want to see, I was able to improve our unit by doing X, and it resulted in Y. And we improved our efficiency by 10%. And by doing this, we were able to increase partnerships with our core constituents, and put some numbers behind it. That's really going to tell much more of a story than what you put in a job description. So I highly encourage you to ask yourself, what did I accomplish? And if you can answer that question, that's what you put down. Again, at the end of all that, proofread, spell check, format it again. We do distinguish between roles that are part-time, volunteer, or internships. Internships do not receive full credit in terms of time. We only give credit for an internship if it's longer than 6 months, and even then it's only 50%. So if you had an internship for 6 months and you wanted that to qualify you for a position, just know that if it was 6 months, we'd only give you credit for 3 months. If it was a 3 month internship, we wouldn't give you credit at all. Similar concept for part-time positions. We will only credit you for the percentage of time that you were actually working. So if you worked part-time for your local police department in the records unit, we'd give you 20% credit based off of what your pay stubs showed. And volunteer work, similar format. After you do that, proofread, spell check, and format it again. Make sure it reads correctly. One thing that is not a concern for us, but something that we want you to be proactive with, is if you have an employment gap, we want you to get out in front of it. Maybe you took time off to raise a child. Maybe you took a sabbatical. Maybe you had sick parents at home, or you wanted to retool and get a new degree and come back into the workforce in a different area. All of those things are certainly very valuable and noble in their own right, and we encourage you to address that in the CV so that we don't have to ask the question, what happened between these years and those years. It just helps answer those questions and puts you in the best light possible before we move on with your application. So you've researched the position, you've submitted your application, you've formatted, you've edited, you've made your application just perfect, and now it's time to get ready for an interview. You've been contacted by us, and we want to interview you for a position. For an interview that we use professionals throughout the organization, not just the hiring unit that is filling the position. We ask you questions in three different categories. What is your motivation for the position? What are your technical skills for the position? And what are your soft skills when working with others? And we evaluate you on those three categories. So this is probably one of the biggest takeaways from today's webinar is how you can structure your responses and keep those three things in mind. If you can pepper your responses on how your motivation and your technical skills and your soft skills continually make you the best person for the job because you're an expert in the field, because you want to work for Interpol, because of this specific subject matter, because you've dealt with difficult topics in the past and you're here to solve problems because you're an expert in that area and you've done it in the past and you've done it well with other people. Those are the kinds of things that we want to hear. If you speak one of our four official languages, at least at a working level, like I mentioned earlier, B1, we will normally ask you a question in that language, assuming somebody on the panel speaks that language, to verify what your level might be. So if you just know some basic conversational elements of that language, we will not do that. If you say, I am fluent in Spanish, and we have a Spanish speaker on the panel, we're probably going to ask you a question in Spanish to gauge how good your Spanish actually might be. Our interviews typically last between 40 and 50 minutes, and so during that time you can anticipate somewhere between 8 to 12 questions from our side. And if you do the math, that means that you have approximately 3 minutes per question to demonstrate your expertise in that question. So practice that. Get out a timer, look in the mirror, prepare questions that you think we might ask, keep notes of things that you think are relevant that you would like to bring up, and time yourself to really be on point when you're executing an interview like that. What you want to avoid, and what happens quite frequently, is you have a question, you spin your wheels for a few minutes trying to find a response, and so then 3 minutes have gone by, the panel hasn't learned anything really of substance from you, and then you start answering the question, and then we're starting to run behind and we might not have time to get through everything. So really try and time yourself, make sure that you can deliver a solid response in 3 minutes or less. We encourage you to use what's called the STAR method. That means situation, task, action, and resolution or response. And so you simply state what was going on, what tasks had to be accomplished, what you did specifically, and what the result of that action was. And if you can do that and embellish it just right, that's going to give us a solid response in a timely fashion and really shows us that you know your own background and you're able to communicate that to us effectively in a short time frame. And then it's always good to come prepared with at least two good questions to ask the panel. We try and leave time at the end of the interview so that you can ask us questions about the position or about working at Interpol or what the unit is like or strategic elements that you want to know. And at the end of the day, an interview really should be a two-way conversation. And so we want to make sure that there's time for that. We encourage you to come prepared with two questions that you'd like to ask the panel and know those in advance. So that is everything I had on the agenda for today. I'll go ahead and pause here. We have been receiving questions throughout the webinar today. That sounds like there's 500, and we're going to start with some questions about internships. Let's see. So the first from Noah. When do you publish internship positions? So Noah, good question. We publish internships throughout the year. Interns form a solid critical part of our organizational culture. We have interns throughout the organization and those interns often join us throughout the year. So there's no specific set time. We don't have a young professionals program or a context that is similar to that. So when a unit decides that they have the funding and the need for an intern, we'll open up those positions throughout the year. You just have to keep an eye out on the website. So next we have Jean-Louis looking for a role as an internship and as a penetration tester and ethical hacker. That role is quite specific, and so I don't know if you necessarily find an internship in that particular field. But you can look for internships with our Office of Internal Oversight, which includes our cybersecurity team. You can look for positions with our information systems team. And otherwise, we also have an ethics team as well. So that would be my suggestion in that situation. Next, Clara. I'm a student in geopolitics looking for an internship next year. When should I start looking at the website, and how long before starting are the internship opportunities posted on the portal? Well, that will depend. I'll say it this way. When you see an internship posted, it's still going to take approximately 3 to 6 months before you will actually start, generally speaking. And that's because you still have to go through an onboarding period where we do a criminal records check. And then if you do live outside of France or Singapore, you actually have to relocate to that duty station. So there's some time built in there. So if you're looking to start an internship in January of next year, well, the time to start looking is now. There are several internships that are open. But what I would generally counsel you, Clara, to do is, let's say you want an internship in September, I would start looking in February, March, because that's when that timeline would overlap for the beginning of the fall semester. Okay, I think this next question is from Olivier Thomas. What would be the target position for someone that speaks all four of our official languages? Well, and any position would be great for that. The advantage to speaking all four languages is that you are able to adapt to any different situation. So if we have a conference, if we have a working meeting or a working group, Or if we have correspondence that's coming into our unit. So for example, in HR, we have people who speak all four languages. I certainly do not. So I might ask my colleague to please quickly translate this message that we've received from an Arabic-speaking nation. That's the real advantage. I can't say that there's necessarily a position that you should apply for because you speak all four languages, but it is a large advantage when you do. All right, a question about third-party organizations contracting with the organization. So if you have a specific skill set, we do have a procurement and call for tender process at the organization that you can find on our website if you navigate to that particular section. Remote work. So this has obviously been a hot topic since COVID. We do have a hybrid work policy here at Interpol. Generally speaking, that means that you are in the office 3 days a week and you can telework 2 days a week. We also have 10 special teleworking days that you can use anytime during the year from anywhere that any country that is one of our member nations. So in general, yes, there's quite a bit of flexibility. There's quite a bit of opportunity for telework. But yeah, you should expect to be in the office at least 3 days a week. Are there any opportunities for an experienced PR communications with previous experience at the UK Police Force? That question comes from Samantha. Yes, Samantha, there have been actually quite a few in our comm directorate in the last year. I'm trying to think. I just opened one not too long ago, but it was more for multimedia and graphic design. So yes, there are opportunities from time to time. Currently, I don't think we have anything on the books. Is there an age limit to work at Interpol? Yes, you must be at least 18 years old and you must be less than 65 years old. We have a mandatory retirement age at 65 unless there is a waiver provided by the Secretary General. Question from Lena. Are internships only offered in Lyon and Singapore, or are they offered in other duty stations? I am struggling to think of a time when we had an intern that was not at Lyon or Singapore. I'm almost entirely certain that interns must be in Lyon or Singapore. And unless there was a specific business need, but it would be rare. It would be rare. Is there a possibility to work as a freelance translator? I believe there are, but again, those would go through our procurement units to become, because you'd be a contractor to the organization, not through a recruitment process. A question from Salome. What kind of CV format is accepted, and is a photo important on the CV? So we don't have a specific format required. Salome, the most important thing is the information that you put on there. The Europass model is quite good. I see it very frequently. But the most important thing is that it's clear. The information is concise. The information is relevant. You want to avoid using all that block text like I mentioned earlier. And is a photo necessary? No, not really. In fact, I would discourage a photo on the CV. Simply because you're applying, you're going to have to provide us with your passport anyway. So we're going to see that photo already. So take that extra 5 square centimeters and use it to tell us more about you and what you bring to the table. Next question. How much time is there between the publication of the offer and the deadline? Some organizations publish the offers 1 year in advance for security and administrative reasons. And that's from Justine. publication of the offer and the deadline. So it depends on the position. Justine, for an external contracted position, we are going to open that position for 3 weeks. For a seconded position where you're supported by your home government, we publish those positions for at least 2 months. So, and then the reason being it takes longer for those governments to provide the support to the candidate. They have to go through their process to determine that, yes, they have the funding, they have the availability, and they are willing to send that person to Interpol. Let's see, next question. Vladislav. Are these vacancies for people from all over the world or just the USA? Which countries are the vacancies covering? Good question, Vladislav. If you didn't catch on, I have a heavy American accent. So the question is no. The positions are open to anybody who is a national of a member country of Interpol. And there are 196 different nations representing Interpol. And so the odds are very, very strong that you can apply. There are only a few nations that are not members of Interpol. Wendy asks, for a seconded position, is the salary paid by our government or by Interpol? Thanks, Wendy. Good question, and important to understand the difference. So if you're seconded, if you apply for a seconded position, that means your government is paying your salary, and Interpol is not paying anything except perhaps an expatriation allowance. So that's why we require a letter of support from the officials that say, yes, we're going to support this person, we're going to pay them, we're going to take care of them. If they have a health concern, the government's on the hook. Interpol is just accepting them as a subject matter expert and as a liaison between Interpol and that government. The next question, I speak some French and a little teeny bit of both Spanish and Arabic. What are the possibilities? Well, I would encourage you to be honest in your resume so that you are legitimately saying what you actually do speak. If you speak a teeny bit of French, maybe that's an A2, maybe B1, just know that if you put that down, we're going to ask you a question about it in your interview. And so the language, again, is not nearly so important. As long as you do speak English, the language is not nearly as important as your expertise in that particular position. Next question is from Simon. Most of the vacancies posted on both sites are related to secondment. Yes, that is true, Simon. And there's a couple of reasons for that. Part of it is just timing. Like I mentioned just a few minutes ago, we publish the contracted positions only for 3 weeks and the secondments for 2 months. And so if it is entirely possible that we could have multiple contracted positions that come up on the website and leave the website in the time that one secondment is on there. And depending on what positions are available at any given time, yes, it could appear that we only accept secondments. But we just know, Simon, that we do recruit for both types of positions throughout the year. All right, next question is from, let's see the name, Jean-Michel. Are there any possibilities to integrate into services via secondment since I am a civil servant in France? Catégorie B. Yes, I suppose it is possible. You would need to work that out with your administration. Depending on, I don't know what your role is specifically, but depending on what your role is, if there is a position at Interpol that would be of interest to you and your employer, you can work that out. And then you would also need to get your employer to route that through the Bureau Central National de France. Have that routed to us through that BCN. So, yes, it can be done. You don't have to be a law enforcement officer to do it. And I would encourage you to pursue those opportunities. Catherine asks, are there really no possibility of remote or home-based positions with Interpol? Unfortunately, Catherine, no, there are not. In terms of a permanent position, full-time, no, there's nothing available on that market. There's a variety of reasons I could give, but at the end of the day, the quickest answer to your question is no. Do you propose internships abroad for students from with a bachelor's degree from Sciences Po? So Florence, I'm not sure if I entirely understand the question. Do we accept interns from all countries? Yes. As long as you are a national of one of our 196 member countries, you can apply for an internship with us. You just must be a current student or recently graduated student. If you are coming from abroad, please know, as an intern or as a contracted officer, that we will take care of your visa. We will sponsor your visa, and we will make sure that you are legally able to complete your internship here in France or in Singapore when that time comes. Okay. Last question on this one is from Goswami. What about engineers? Any vacancy for engineers? Well, if we're talking civil engineering, mechanical engineering, things like that, probably not. If we're IT engineering, yes, there are opportunities in that field within our information services directorate. Question from Victoria. What does the written assessment consist of? So it depends on the position. The position, if you're applying for an administrative position, I'll use that as a good example, because that's often a way that people enter Interpol's workforce, is as a team assistant. It's a grade 8, it's our lowest level recruited internationally position. Then we have administrative assistants, and then we have principal assistants, because they kind of grow in grade. So let's take that as an example. We're going to assess your ability to write, to proofread, to work with Excel, and to work through a complex scenario, probably time management or something like that. That's a fairly common scenario that we run into. If you're going into the project management field, then we'll ask questions about project management, different elements of project management, areas in which we might find, choke points in project management, things like that. But what I would encourage you to do, no matter what the position is, you open up the terms of assignment or the job description, you look at that and it says, duty 1, duty 2, duty 3, duty 4, whatever the number of job-related duties are, and you say, what is a question that they could ask me about that thing? And that is what you prepare for the test. Also for the interview, we're going to take the job description and we're going to ask questions that are relevant to the job based off of what we're asking you to be able to do. So we do in tests in two different ways. Depending on the position, we might send you a Word doc and you need to work on that Word doc during a specified time limit, usually 2 or 3 hours, and then you send it back to us. We also have an online portal that you might be sent to where you have to do all the work within that portal within a time limit. And either way, the questions would largely be the same. It's just the format that it takes. All right. Question from Kuldeep. What is the required level of competency? What are the major reasons for the disqualification of applications you receive for the openings? Okay, so interesting question. The first things that we screen for are language, education, and experience. So if we require you to speak English and you do not have at least that B2 level of English, which we call professional fluency, you will get screened out. if you do not have the required degree or a degree at least similar, you will get screened out. There's usually a question on the application that says, how many years of experience do you have doing this job? And if you don't meet the minimum qualifications on that experience, you will get screened out. So I'd say those are the three most common. And in that situation, those individuals will not proceed forward for additional screening. Thank you for all of your questions. We tried to get through all of them as quickly as we could. And thank you to everybody who tuned into the webinar. Let us know how you liked it. We have a Slido that you can use this QR code. It'll take you to a participant survey. We'll leave this on screen for just a few minutes. And you can also fill out the survey after we close down the webinar. So feel free to fill that in at your convenience over the next day or two. But we really look forward to seeing your applications in the future. We appreciate your interest in working at Interpol, and we hope you have a wonderful day no matter where you are in the world. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.